How did humans manage to sleep during the Ice Age without freezing to death? The cold isn't even surprising anymore. It's a constant, gnawing, working its way into your bones every time you take a breath. You could lie down in the snow right now, let your body sink into it, and it would be all over. Quick, quiet, just cold. The predators that stalked the tundra would be along soon enough to make quick work of your frozen body. But that's not an option. You are not just fighting for you, you're fighting for your family, your wife, who offers her silent support as you force your way forward. Your son, already in his 12th winter and steady by your side as you hunt, he'll be able to care for the family when the time comes. And your daughter, only 6 winters old, pushing on through the bitter wind, every step a fight against her fragile health. You continue marching. It's the only thing you can do. During the day, you search for refuge. Sometimes, if you're lucky, the sun offers some much-needed warmth. You can pick up some speed, make up ground, and gain strength. But other days, the sun is cloaked in shadow. The snow is relentless, and every step forward takes effort. You notice your daughter starting to lag behind, and your son quickly urges her forward. There's no time to waste. You have to find shelter, because night is coming. Sure, the day is harsh, but night brings its own hazards. The temperature drops, the winds rise, and the darkness presses in from all sides. And as fatigue settles over you, you know one thing is for certain. Staying outside during this weather, even for a moment too long, it could mean instant death. If the elements don't get you, the predators will. You need to find shelter, a cave. There are plenty scattered across the area, but that doesn't mean that they're suitable. Some aren't big enough for your family, others sit directly in the path of the wind, making them far too bitterly cold for you to ever light a fire. And the others, they're already occupied. You remember it like it was yesterday. You were just a boy, ordered to stay behind as your father and your older brother explored the caves for shelter. You never saw them again, only their screams echoing from inside of the cave. And then, the roar. That awful, earth-shattering roar of a bear. These beasts lurk deep in their dens, always eager to welcome a new meal that wanders too close. After that day, your mother did everything she could to keep you alive. She gave you food, warmth, and shelter, even when it meant that she went without. Her early death was no mystery. You understood the cost she paid. She never regretted it, and if the time comes, neither will you. The sun disappears further behind the horizon, and what little light remains dims. Then you see it, a large cave, out of the direction of the wind. It's small, but it'll do. You won't make the mistake your father did. You tell your son, stay behind, to guard his mother and sister. You carefully enter the cave, and the shift is immediate. The wind disappears, and the still air wraps around, offering a kind of relief. You gather some tinder and you pick up 2 sharp rocks from within. You've done this so many times it feels almost automatic now. You strike the stones together, once, twice, again. On the 4th hit, a spark leaps out. You coax it gently, feeding it with fibers until the flame catches. It's enough. You lower a stick to it, nursing it into a makeshift torch. Now comes the moment of truth. If the worst happens, your son knows to run and not look back. You hurl the torch deep into the cave. If there's something in there, it'll wake up. And you'll run. If it's a bear, it'll attack the moment you disturb it, but it's less likely to chase you outside of the den and abandon its shelter. You've given your family a fleeting chance, and you might have one too if your feet don't betray you. The torchlight pushes deeper into the cave, painting the stone in a flickering orange. You hold your breath and you listen, waiting for that telltale rumble, that low, rising roar that means the beast is awake. Instead, there's only a small squeal. A large, furry rodent scuttles out of the cave and you move further in. It's a safe hideaway, and you let out a shout of triumph to your family. You have found your haven. Your family joins you inside of the cave, and you get to work. Your wife and son brought plenty of additional sticks and logs to build it up, and soon you'll have built up an impressive fire. Much of the smoke will escape the cave, but the warmth will protect you as the temperature plunges. Combined with the heavy fur clothing you all wear, it'll be enough to see you through the night, just as it's done so many times before. Your daughter curls up beside the fire almost immediately, her cough mixing in with the crackling flames. Your wife settles the large fur blanket over her, and as you watch, you know your day hasn't finished. It's time to go hunting. The sun is almost gone behind the clouds now, and soon the world will fall into total darkness. You take a moment to orient yourself, marking the path back to the cave so you can return easily. You're not hunting large prey tonight, you're only a small group, and you don't need much meat. You do need sustenance, and the effort to trap and move a large animal would use up too much energy. Instead, you crouch in the grass, waiting, until you see a rustling. A fat, rabbit-sized creature steps out to nibble at the few remaining plants. You stealthily move toward it, but it spots you and turns to bolt. Your son comes at it from the other side, spearing it with a sharpened stick. And then you hear it, your signal to make your way back. The The howling of wolves. It's common in this area. They're a threat in their own right, and they have no problem hunting humans. You quickly retreat back to the cave, carrying your quarry with you. As you sit by the fire, you strip off the skin and prepare it for drying. The carcass, meanwhile, is placed over the open flame and roasted. Everyone gets their share, preparing them for the next day. And now it's time for sleep. And this is the dangerous part. Safe in your den, it's the one chance you have for rest. The fire will scare off any scrounging predators, and you'll have plenty of warning should anyone brave it. But the temperatures are going to drop steeply during the night. You take out the most precious possession you have, the dried animal skins that have been collecting over the years. Some have been painstakingly sewed by your wife into tight-fitting clothing, using only a simple bone needle. Others make for effective fur blankets. You distribute them around, making sure to drape some extra over your daughter, and as the cold seeps in, you drift off to sleep. There's a deep chill in your bones as you awaken, and the seconds you spend waiting for your family to stir feel like an eternity. Your wife is the first to move beside you, blinking awake, and a gentle nudge from your foot rouses your son. Your daughter takes longer. She coughs the moment her eyes open, and her mother pulls her close, whispering softly until the fit passes. The cave is far from ideal, too cold, too smoky, too cramped, but it kept you alive through the night, and for now that's enough. You gather your belongings and you make sure to strip the rabbit carcass clean of what little meat remains before setting out for more hospitable conditions. But you know time is running out. Your previous home had served you well in the past years. It was a sturdy one built from rocks and mammoth bones. You remember salvaging what meat you could from the massive carcass that had been ravaged by predators. The scavengers finished the job, and what was left was a massive skeleton. The carved bones made an effective shield when placed just right, and you used simple tools to set it together. But as time went on, the weather got colder with each passing year, and you knew the family wouldn't survive another. It was time to head towards the sun in search of a new permanent shelter. You can only hope that when someone finally stumbles across your old home, they'll understand what you left behind. The rock walls of the shelter play host to your children's paintings, made from the ash of the fire. You and your wife added some of your own, of course. They were simple sketches of your daily life, but it was yours. You couldn't take it with you, but one day when it gets warmer, maybe another family will see it and know someone just like them shared this space. But for now, your world has shrunk to the small leather bags three of you carry. Only the essentials, some foraged food for the hike, and the clothing that you can carry. And of course, the tools. Everything you carry was created painstakingly through a lot of trial and error. Bone shards were carefully shaped into spearheads and attached to sturdy sticks with dried vines. They're light, but they can easily impale a small animal or slash the skin of a predator. And then there's your rock chisel, the tool that lets you make other tools. Everything you use is sharpened by hand, carved from whatever nature offers. But you've harnessed its power to give you an advantage in this unforgiving landscape. That is, if you can survive the cold. It's another bitter day. You have to take out several of the hide blankets that you used at night, draping one around your shoulders. You hand the others to your family. The snow will make them wet, but the added insulation will protect you and they can be dried by the fire once you find shelter. If you find shelter, you signal to move forward and your daughter takes two steps and stumbles. The added weight is bearing down on her and she has so little strength as it is. Without a word, your wife bends down, placing her securely on her back. She squares her jaw and starts walking. If she can make it, so can you. The rest of the day is spent foraging, forcing your way through snowdrifts and watching for predators and prey. You encounter only one other group on your journey moving in the same direction. A group of older men who at first appear hostile. Then they level their spears at you and you and your son mirror the gesture, muscles tight, breath held. But no one attacks. The moment hangs in the cold, brittle air, and then it passes. They look like you, but not quite. Stockier, more muscular, shorter, built for this climate. You give them a nod, allowing them to continue on their way. They afford you the same courtesy. You watch as they move through the hostile terrain with an ease that unsettles you, hunting and gathering as if the cold barely touches them. But for you, every day is a countdown. The intense snowdrifts today mean it's not nearly as easy to move forward as it was yesterday. Your priority is finding shelter, and you eventually come across an abandoned shelter similar to your own. From the look of the terrain, this is the wall of a riverbed which has carved a protective overhang. You should be able to shelter beneath it. And this is where your extra baggage pays off. The overhang blocks the worst of the wind, and by hanging your largest hides along the front, weighted down with stones, you can then turn them into crude curtains. It won't be perfect, but it will hold. Then you head out to collect firewood. Another fire means another chance at warmth, and thankfully there's enough dry timber scattered nearby to make it possible. But now, you have to keep going. Your wife and daughter are protected from the elements for now, a small fire burning underneath the shelter. Your son is used to the routine by now. From the moment he was old enough to hold a tool, you taught him to hunt, to gather, to create fire, just like your father did for you and your brother. Tonight, you'll both go out and scout for prey, but that's not the priority. You'll need firewood if you're going to survive the night. The flames you've built won't last forever, and the clock is already ticking. And you're in new terrain. As you head out of the shelter, spears at the ready, you guide yourself using the sun. You know the direction most of the migrations happen, so you're heading in the direction where it typically gets warmer. It's a day-by-day operation, but if everyone gets strong, one day soon you'll be in a paradise, a place where you can ride out the winter with relative ease, a place where your daughter will get stronger, and where maybe you can find others to join. But for now, there's only one goal: survive. But as you advance, disaster strikes. The wind picks up suddenly, and with it, the snow. A thick, blinding wall of white that swallows the world in seconds. You shout for your son to grab your clothing, but your voice gets torn away by the gale. If you're separated now, you'll never find each other again. Your eyes burn, your skin prickles. You fight to keep your bearings, because you know you're not the only thing out. And many of the creatures out here are far better equipped for this deadly weather than a lone man and his son. And that's when you hear the growl. The massive wolf comes out of nowhere, bloodlust in its eyes. Normally, it would be a competitor hunting animals like you, but this one is separated from its pack and it is consumed with confusion, rage, and pain. Right now, it only sees one thing: prey. You throw yourself in front of your son, ripping your spear free as fast as your frozen hands will allow. The wolf lunges and you thrust the wooden shaft between its jaws. Its weight slams against you. It twists, snarls, saliva dripping from its fangs. It struggles and it backs up slightly, ready to pounce again. You'll only get one shot at this. You lunge forward as the wolf attacks and score a direct hit. The spear rips the wolf's neck. Its howl pierces the raging gale. As it tumbles to the ground, blood staining the snow, you thrust the spear deeper and deeper until it stops moving. But there's no time to celebrate. The wind is hitting its peak. You grab hold of the wolf's carcass, muscles trembling, and motion to your son, telling him to crouch beneath it. The still warm body protects you from the raging storm. You don't know how long it lasts, but eventually the wind begins to ease. The snow thins, and the storm finally loosens its grip. You push the wolf's body aside and climb out from beneath your makeshift shelter and step into a new world. The terrain is unrecognizable, buried under fresh drifts. Every landmark is gone. And as you turn in a slow circle searching for something, anything that looks familiar, a cold realization creeps over you. How are you going to find your way back? The sun is set, the path you followed is obscured. All you can do is turn back and hope that you spot something you remember. Several attempts show only new ground, but eventually you notice a fallen tree that you passed earlier. You collect the firewood but leave the wolf carcass behind. It's far too heavy, and you need to get back to the shelter as soon as possible. You don't know if the fire held up or how long your wife and daughter could hold out. It feels like ages, but eventually you come across the telltale mark of the river overhang, but your heart freezes in your chest as you approach. The entire area is covered in snowdrifts. There's no way a fire could survive in these conditions. You motion to your son to stay up above and descend into the small ravine. And then you dig, tearing through the snow in search of the crevasse that holds the rest of your family. Eventually you break through and you see what you feared the most. The fire is long out. Curled toward the back of the cave, you see your wife. She's covered with the blankets you left behind, having piled them over her. She was using her own body heat to try to shield your daughter, but you reach out to touch them, and both are cold as ice. You are too late. You emerge from the shelter, your son looking at you with expectant eyes. You slowly shake your head. It's the hardest thing you've ever had to do, but he still has one parent left, and you're going to continue protecting him, continue teaching him, until you're no longer able to. You bury your wife and daughter on a hill above the shelter, leaving small rocks to mark their resting spots. But there is no time to reflect. Grieving will have to be done on the go. The march continues. You and your son gather your belongings and set out. He shoulders more than his burden this time. There are many more hard days and brutal nights, but the two of you make it through. Slowly but surely, the bitter cold starts to lessen, but only a little. The sun stays out longer, the nights are more bearable, the seasons are changing, and then one day you hear strange noises drifting from a nearby water source. You and your son move carefully, staying low, as you approach the sound. It's a group, a small colony of people gathered along a bank. They must have been wandering too. There are many individuals, some carrying children, only a few clustered as families. Thin, worn, but alive, survivors of the brutal winter. Hesitantly, you step forward. You have skills, strength, and the hard-earned knowledge of survival. Eyes turn toward you, wary, cautious, but hopeful. And in that moment, you feel it. A new chapter is beginning. For you, for your son, for everyone. Now, go watch what a day in the life of a Neanderthal was like, or click on this video instead.